Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, we give you praise. We give you glory, O God. You're worthy of praise and glory and adoration. Lord, you're worthy. There is none like you. Your name is high and lifted up, O God. Be exalted, O God, even as we have this second broadcast this year, following the Kesha. We praise you, Father, and we give you preeminence. We give you the most high place, O God. We call you King. We call you Lord. We call you Jehovah, mighty God, the mighty man of war. We exalt you, Lord, Jehovah, King of glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Great is thy faithfulness, O God. Hallelujah. We worship you, God. Hallelujah. Sorry, guys, it's a little dark. I've really tried to get in better lighting and all that. I'll come more prepared tomorrow. So let me see if I move closer, then that helps. All right, so let's see. We've got Grace Kiambi. Uh-huh. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Maria's joined. Hallelujah. Maria, miska home. Good to see you coming live. Lorna, Kate Werimo, Karibuni Sana. Good to see you, my sisters. Mary Wanjira Karaoke, Karibu Sana. And Esther Gitahi, hallelujah. Karibu Sana, Esther. Good to see you. And Jeff, happy new year. Pastor Kathy, happy new year. And Jeff. Amen. And I see Werimu Muya as well saying happy new year. So happy new year, everybody. It's a brand new year and we bless the Lord for second chances. Sorry, it's a little dark. I hope you can see me. I was barely on the verge of even getting candles. I'm like, what's with the lighting? Yeah, but we'll get it better tomorrow. We'll do better. So today is my first day in the office and full-time ministry. You know, you kind of expect, you know, I don't know what I expected. I don't know if I expected angels with trumpets, you know. Yeah, but really, you know, it was a very ordinary day. The only difference I think I can say is just the joy. So much joy of knowing that I've entered into my calling full time. And then, of course, just remembering various things and remembering, you know, how when I was about 11 or 12 years old in a Catholic school in Western Kenya, I went to the convent and I said, I want to be a nun, you know, and the sisters were quite concerned about it. And, you know, they just made me keep coming. And then, of course, you know, we're given tasks like removing, what do you even call it? Kudondoa Mahindi, you know? I don't know what it's called. We used to call it Kudondoa Mahindi, you know, when you have maize and you're taking it off the cob. And, you know, I'll go there, you know, pretty much every day. And I thought they looked really holy and cool and everything. But after a few weeks of going there, I remember noticing two things. One thing I noticed was that they were going through a period of, you know, nuns have this period where they go quiet. They don't talk to each other. They don't talk. All they do is meditate and think about God. So that was the first step I knew. I cannot keep quiet. I think for how long? Do a month? Like, I like 40 days. I'm like, maybe not. Then the second thing was, of course, you know, being asked, are you prepared to not get married, not have children? And I knew that that wasn't going to work for me. But it's interesting how God works. And really, I've been finding myself thinking, especially today, about children. And it's one of the things I want to talk to you about. Because, you know, looking back, I think I've had a call of God on my life throughout, you know, and I've always been that strange child. And I think a lot of parents would call their children strange, not realizing that really is the call of God on their lives. So things like having all these dreams, hearing stuff that other people cannot hear, you know, like, yeah, we hear voices, prophets hear voices, you know, and the voice of God, of course. And sometimes you hear other voices that are not necessarily the voice of God, but God wants you to hear stuff. So just to encourage parents to begin with, or this broadcast, particular to parents who have children with a call of God on their life. Observe your child, protect them, shield them, help them to understand, because you know they're just little, and they just find themselves with these thoughts, these things, and they really, really need a parent to encourage them and tell them, you know, God is actually calling you, there's a call of God on your life, God's gonna use you, and all that, so that they can begin also to understand the things that happen to them in their lives and the things that go on with them. So that's the first thing that I wanted to just get out of the way in terms of protecting children. And my nose is so itchy. Oh my God. Give me just a sec, guys. I need to get, I don't know why I start broadcast. Jean-Marie is having a good laugh. I start broadcast and then I remember, oh, you know, I normally need to blow my nose or I'll cry or something. Which is another reason why I don't wear makeup, because there's no point. There we go. There's no point, you know, wearing makeup. Well, it's just going to run down my cheeks and I'm going to cry. So the other thing I wanted to discuss is the pace for this year and the issue of revival. And, you know, once again, just talking about what is this revival? And the Lord led me today to study about the Welsh revival. I woke up studying, you know, the Welsh revival after prayer, and the Lord just led me there. And, you know, it's interesting that the Welsh revival was just about 2 years. It lasted just about 2 years. And I think one of the things I've been trying to unlock and to understand through the last, I think, 5 years into 6 years this year is the issue of revival and why revival doesn't stay permanently. Why is revival only, for a time? Why is it only for a period? Why does it come, you know, even in Kenya when it came for years, yes, quite a number of years. They say 50s, 60s it grew, 70s began to go down, 80s or peaked around the 80s, and then again in the 90s it began to go down. So why doesn't revival last? And yet when you read the Bible, you don't read much about revival other than the day of Pentecost, but beyond the day of Pentecost, that's as far as you go. And one of the things that the Holy Spirit made very clear to me is that revival is not talked about in the Bible other than the day of Pentecost, because the apostles lived in a revived state. They lived in a revived state. They walked with the Holy Spirit. They walked in a great awareness that they were different, that they were called as a peculiar people, as a chosen generation, as a completely different race. So they didn't need to be reminded, because they chose to walk like that right from the time that the Pentecost came down in the book of Acts. And then, you know, went on then to study the different kinds of revivals and everything. And let me tell you today about the Welsh revival. I talk a lot about the Fiji revival, but I want to talk about the Welsh revival today. And my prayer and my hope is, and you know, I was crying this to the Holy Spirit in the morning. I was saying, I can talk to them, I can teach them, I can speak of it, but only you can imprint it on the hearts of people. You know, the Holy Spirit is the one who can give us that desire for revival. And remember, revival does not come through preaching. Revival does not come through singing. Revival comes through prayer. There is no shortcut, and it's not just one person praying. It's different people awakening to the need to pray, the need to call on the name of the Lord, the need for a nation to be set free, or a community to be set free, the need for the church to see the glory of God. And then in that whole process, then the glory of God descends in a mighty way. Now, when I was studying about the Welsh revival came through a guy called Evans Darwin, I think, if I remember well. And he lived in the 1870s into the early 1870s into the early 1900s. But the saddest thing about this guy is that although he had the call of God on his life right from the beginning, he lived for 71 years, but he only served God for 7 years. And the reason why he only served God for 7 years is because he got so caught up in controversy, and especially journalists. You know, in every revival, there will be media coverage every single time. Because remember, revival is a great move of God. There are miracles, there are signs, there are wonders. And sooner or later, a journalist from them days, even the time of Christ, they will come to find information, because also remember, they are paid to find information and to let people know what's going on. And a story of revival is an amazing story. And very often, of course, they will try to poke holes into it and to move things into it. We look at Maria Woodworth Etta in particular, preaching, which was one of the revivalists that God really, really used. And when we look back at Maria Woodworth Etta, of course, not in Wales, but I think more in England, but Maria Woodworth Etta had a journalist come in front and start to insult her. And he was just shouting all these insults. But she was in such a zone, because the thing with revivalists is that they move in a zone. So she was in a zone, a very high zone of the move of the Holy Spirit. And in that zone, by the way, you don't care. You can say anything. You can do just about anything, because you're moving in the supernatural power of God, and you're just a vessel, and the glory of God is heavily upon you. And one of the things that happened to Maria Woodworth Etta is that she wasn't hearing what this guy was saying, and she wasn't noticing anything to do with what the guy was saying. But what happened to this guy is that as he was in the presence of the glory of God, in front of this vessel of a wonderful woman who was called Mother Etta, you know, and cursing and, you know, insulting and everything, his mouth got stuck and his tongue stuck to the roof of his mouth. And, you know, just like the Bible says, that their tongues shall stick to the roof of their mouths, part of what God says about our enemies. And he was stuck there just like, and he couldn't say anything. He was just thinking. And people were watching. And when he came, finally, he was released. But then this woman did not notice, continued with a focus on the glory of God, because we must keep our eyes on God. When God is moving, you're in your vessel, you don't control about, you know, whatever. And, you know, the Holy Spirit, that's what the Holy Spirit does. And does not mind human beings in terms of opposition, but minds in terms of care, in terms of love, in terms of mercy, in terms of the overflow of God, and God reaching out to man, which is what God does. You know, he reaches out to man with such love, such intensity. And that's the level she was at. But this guy was stuck. And finally, when he was released by the Spirit of God or the angels of God, you know, we'll know in eternity what that was exactly. When the guy got to the back, he ran all the way to the back. And when he got to the back, people were asking him, what happened to you in front there? And the guy just looked at them and told them, you go in front there, and then you can come and tell me what happened. He never spoke about it. So going back again to Evans, this Evans guy, you know, he was used heavily of the Lord, mightily of the Lord. He would just need to appear, and, you know, he sparked off revival just by his presence. And then, you know, it would spark off revival in different sanctuaries. But the amazing thing is that 7 years only is how long God used him for. Rather, that is when he allowed himself to be used for. Because, you know, when you're called for a lifetime. You're not called for just a period of time or for just a short time. But you must allow God, because God is a gentleman. So this guy, was under so much opposition, was attacked so much. He moved under the power of the Holy Spirit so heavily and did not get any rest until he had a breakdown. And he had many breakdowns. And the fourth one, unfortunately, a woman with a Jezebel spirit came and picked him and went away with him to a different land, claiming that she was going to lead him into healing. And all she did was focus on letting him know that he made a lot of mistakes. And Evans believed that, he was actually, the revival was actually a move of the enemy, and he spent the rest of his life really repenting and crying to God because he thought that he had failed. And it's part of the learning of revival that God was telling me today, that it's important that I teach the children of God about revival and about the move of God, that we need, first of all, to prepare for revival. The mistake I made between 2012 and 2014 is that I moved with a group of people and we would pray for revival every day. And in 2013, 2014, suddenly we had a mighty visitation of God. But imagine, the visitation of God came very briefly and then left because we were not ready. And what people did is the glory of God appeared in the sky in the form of a triangle just above the tent that we were putting up. And when we realized that it was only our compound that had bright light that looked like daytime and the rest of the compounds were dark, instead of people getting into worship and everything, guys scattered and hid under the tent and began to hide, take cover in different places. And for me, I cried all the way home. But as I look back, I could have called on the name of the Lord. I could have welcomed the Holy Spirit. I could have glorified him and thanked him, but we were not prepared. And part of what we are doing right now, as we prepare to receive the full blow of revival, it's already here, by the way, and I'm going to share with you shortly about something that happened, something amazing that has happened. just to encourage you. So revival is already here, but for it to pour completely, we need to be prepared, and we need to know that God loves us. He's not coming to judge us. He's coming to encourage us. He's coming to strengthen us, and he's coming to use us for the end time work of God before Jesus, the Son of God, comes back in his second return. As he comes back for the saints of God, you know, in the rapture, that's what I'm talking about. And in particular, I want to just talk about preparation. The preparation that we need to enter into includes the fast that we're doing right now. We're doing a 21-day fast, and people are laughing about the move. I don't know if phones are acting up. Lynette, is that you? Is your phone acting up again? Anyway, so we need to prepare ourselves, and the preparation is in doing what God said to Moses and to the children of Israel. And what did he say? He said, consecrate yourselves, for I will do wondrous things amongst you. Consecrate yourself, or I will come with visitation amongst you. But when the children of Israel were told that, they began a consecration. But when the time came for God to visit them, they were afraid. They feared. And they told Moses, you go out, meet him, because you guys talk face to face as with a man. Then you come and tell us. But the Lord is looking out for children of God that will not be afraid to consecrate themselves and to meet with him. When he comes, he will come with power. When he comes, he will come with his glory. And let me tell you, the thing with God that we need to be prepared for is that when the glory of God comes, it reveals to you how sinful you are. But then we must remember that it's by the blood of Jesus that we are made righteous. It's by the grace of God, the blood of Jesus, the work of the cross. And so what we must do is prepare ourselves in consecrating and in asking God to prepare us for the mighty visitation of the Lord. So as we're doing this 21-day fast, for those in ministry, I want to encourage you to linger a little. It's all going to be 21 days. We're going to go into February. And for those who are hungrier, we're going to go into February. And really, the kind of fast that we're doing, we're not doing no Daniel fast, because I think we've already identified that Daniel did not really fast in terms of, you know, when we talk about 21 days. The 21 days was just a separation of eating things that were right before God and not a complete hunger, you know. So if you're eating at all, any solids, including porridge, including yogurt, including smoothies, that is not a fast. So fasting, just to be very, very clear, is separation for a time of prayer. And in the separation, we don't eat any solids. We may have liquids because, of course, you know, unless you're under the glory of the Holy Spirit, like Elijah was, like Jesus was, and like Moses was, you cannot really do 40 days, for example, or even 21 days, you know, without having any liquids. By day three, really, the most you can do scientifically would be about 3 days, unless the Spirit of God so moves you, okay? So we are taking a water fast, you can do a water fast for 21 days under the influence of the Spirit of the living God. Remember, we need to be wise as well. And we are taking juices and, of course, tea, if you need to take coffee or whatever it is. Liquids, let's put it that way. That's what we're taking, but we're not taking any solids. For those that are able to, you know, people have different levels of faith, okay? If you've never fasted a day in your life and you don't feel that move of the Holy Spirit, I would encourage you to just fast from midnight and break at 6 p.m. And please break gently, you know, don't bomwa everything and dandia everything. Normally we break with something soft like porridge or some yogurt. And then that's when we take a light meal and allow our bodies to adjust. But then normally when you're fasting, it's not good to do very heavy meals and very big meals and everything. So you just try and take small portions, you know, just something to sustain you through the night, even as you start the next day. And that's how you also train your body, by the way, to get used to not having solids, even to the point of not taking solids. But incidentally, the first time I did a 40-day fast, I actually just fasted. I was reading Good Morning, Holy Spirit. And I got so hungry for the move of God. And I felt in my spirit that the same way God had moved with Benihim, he could move in my life. And I just instantly declared a 40-day fast. And I did not die. And by then, in that process, I even climbed Mount, which one? Gong Hills. I did Gong Hills in that process. And I was just fine. I barely even lost weight, by the way. So it depends on the conviction that you have in your spirit and the hunger that you have for God. But I'm going to tell you something, revival and entering into it, we will have to fast. We will have to sanctify ourselves. Remember, we're not fasting so that God can do something. We are fasting because we are hungry for God and we want our spiritual man to be at the level where God can actually come down and minister to us. That's what we are doing. So quite a bit of self-examination. We're going before God and saying, God, search me, know me, deal with me, Lord. And you know what happens every time you do that is that you have to deal with the pain of the realization of how fallen you are, the realization of what a sinner you are. You become so sensitive to realizing how far you are from God, and yet you ask the Holy Spirit to comfort you and to encourage you so that you don't move into discouragement. Because what easily happens is that you can move into condemnation and into the realization that, whoa, yani, I'm just a jar of clay. But then the word of God talks about us not carrying the anointing in jars of clay. So be encouraged and know that it's just because of God that we move. So I want to talk to you about something that happened. First of all, there's something that's been happening for the last few months, and it's that we are laying hands on the sick and they are instantly recovering. Not just me, but also the people in the ministry, social ministry with me, laying hands on the sick, and guys are being instantly healed. Last night, the other thing we're doing is praying for people, just marking somebody and saying, we're going to pray for you to get saved. We don't tell you, but we pray for you to get saved. We talk to you about Jesus. If you're not ready, we continue to pray for you to get saved, and we call on the name of the Lord, and people are getting saved. So one of my dear friends, who's also joined the ministry that we've gotten, the Covenant of Marriage ministry, we were praying with her and saying, she was saying, my husband needs to rededicate his life to Christ. And it's been a cry of her heart. And she's a dear woman that the Lord sent her away. And so I just enjoined her and began to pray and call on the name of the Lord. And on the 24th of December, which was our Christmas service, by the way, we've never had a Christmas service. Can you imagine? We've had church for the last, since 2013, that's when Sozo Church opened its doors in October, but we've never had a Christmas service. Somehow, we've always shut down and, taken our holidays and taken some rest. But this year, the Lord said, I want you to have a Christmas service on the 24th. So we had a Christmas service. And quite a number of the women that we're working with at the Covenant of Marriage Ministry, where we're teaching women about marriage, and we've been doing it for the last, we're pretty much past halfway through, because we're like on week 7. It's a 10-week ministry. If you haven't joined it, you need to join it, by the way. God is doing amazing things. He's doing amazing things. So quite a number of the women managed to convince their spouses to come to church. So they came to church, and it was so exciting. And you don't want to look too excited unless you scare away the men. But they're walking in, and you're seeing them in the mirror. The way our church is, we have mirrors, so I'll be able to see as they're walking. And the Holy Spirit says, she's managed to bring it so and so. And I'm like, oh, thank you, Jesus. And it was for tears. So anyway, during the altar call, the Lord was very clear that he wanted the soul of one particular man. We did the altar call, and you bow your head and, close your eyes and tell everybody pray. And, I'm eyeing this guy and, I'm thinking, come to Jesus, oh man of God. And I'm hoping he could look up so that I go like, yeah, come to Jesus now, but he wasn't, looking up. He was, in fact, we were laughing about it last night with him, because, his eyes were tightly shut and his head was bowed, and I could feel in the spirit that I could feel it, and in the earlier years, I would walk around to the person and tap them and say, the Lord is calling you, but then I realized, sometimes people just get saved because of the pressure. So anyway, he didn't give his life to Christ that day, but the Lord led me to say a very strange kind of prayer. And I said that there are people here, you are supposed to have given your life to Christ today, but you're refusing. And so we nullify everything that is, giving you any kind of encouragement outside of God. And we declare that you will not have any peace until you give your life to Christ. And we declare that you shall not sleep, you shall not rest. I mean, seriously, it was a very, very strong prayer. And then, of course, said the greatness of our Lord Jesus Christ, etc. Went and said hello to people. Of course, as a few husbands managed to take off before the altar call, and the Lord was very clear that they are running away before the altar call comes. But God's going to arrest them, because you cannot run away from God. So I get, so I said to this man, I've got a message for you from the Lord. And I left it at that. And I said, if I could get your phone number, I don't want to pass on the message to your wife. I want to pass on the message directly to you. So, you know, one of the things I'm used to is that when I tell somebody I have a message for you from the Lord, normally people don't come back to ask me, including my own dad. You know, many years ago, I got a message for him from the Lord, and I was very afraid, and I texted him in the wee hours of the morning. I said, I have a message for you from the Lord. And my dad did not get in touch with me. Then I called him later and I said to him, Daddy, I said I've got a message for you from the Lord. He said, you'll give it to me when you're ready. And, you know, I was expecting to invite me, etc. And he never did. But then when I finally did get the courage to go and tell him, he told me, everything you said, I've never been told your mother or anyone else. Only the Lord knows those things that you're saying to me. And then that's how I led my dad to Christ, by the way. Because that moment I told him, you know, I'm speaking to you as a servant of God and not your little daughter. Then he removed his heart instantly and I asked him, would you like to meet Jesus? And that's how my dad gave his life to Christ after I prayed for him for 20 years and numerous 40-day fasts for my mom and for my dad. And the next day, my mom gave her life to Christ. So, you know, just to let you know, prophecy can be a very, very powerful thing that God can use. So don't refrain if the Lord gives you a word for somebody. So this guy gets in touch with me. By the way, I think he's the first person who's ever told me, I thought you have a word for me from the Lord. Maybe not. Yeah, but very few people that we have. So he sends me a message and says, would you give me the message from the Lord? And I said, okay, you know, continue praying about it. I said, Lord, how do I give this very heavy message to this man? And I sent the message to the man. I said, the Lord wants your soul, and it's very, very clear you'll not have any rest until you obey him and turn to him. And I don't know what's stopping you, but on Sunday, you know very well you should have given your life to Christ. And my prayer is that you would obey in an easier way as opposed to the harder way. So the guy didn't reply, didn't say a thing. I didn't even know whether he had received it, other than the confirmation that the message had been received by Safaricom. So a few days later, I get a message from him, maybe I'll say about 5-6 days later, which was, I think it was yesterday, yes. It was yesterday was the first. I get a message saying, woman of God, I'm traveling, and I'd really like it if you could. If I could meet you so that you can pray for me. And I replied and I said, you want to rededicate your life to Christ. Did you do so before I even come to pray for you? And he replied and he said, yes. Actually, last night I gave my life to Christ. And it's part of the reason why I want to meet you. And I was like, hallelujah, glory be to the name of the Lord. And I ran to the wife and I say, you know, as a woman of God, by the way, you have to learn to be careful. So I asked the wife and I say, hey, your husband wants me to pray for you. Apparently he gave his life to Christ. Are you aware of this story? And she says, yes, you gave your life to Christ as a Kesha. And by the way, we really need to talk because he's not had any rest since last Sunday when you prayed that crazy prayer. And I talked to my husband. He confirmed that he's available. And I blessed the Lord. And you know, she just seen me last night by the way, walking out and saying, oh, God, may I remember this moment for the rest of my life, even as my husband and I are going. And I'm trying to act all natural with my husband. Like, as I'm in full-time ministry, and my husband and I are going to this home to pray for people at night. I wouldn't do so if I was working because tomorrow I'll be in the office. And, you know, I was so excited. I didn't even use the lift, by the way. I was just, you know, trying not to hop, skip, and oh, my God, you know. Then, of course, I calmly attached my arm into my husband's arm, and we're walking together and I'm praying. I'm saying, thank you, Jesus. One day he will be full-time ministry too, you know. And I'm just telling him, honey, thank you for coming with me. So we went to this home, and there was so much joy in this home. You know, there are people who give their lives to Christ and then they are very gentle about it, polite about it. This guy is so excited. First of all, when we got into the home, the first thing my husband noticed is the music. My husband is a worshiper. So he said, you know, they had YouTube on, and I don't know, DJ? Leifa? I don't even know. It sounds almost like life. Anyway, trust me not to know. So my husband says, oh, DJ, this person. And then the guy looked up, you know, they said, is it bad? Is it okay? And I was so excited because this is a guy who's just rededicated his life to Christ after many, many years. But he just wanted to please God. And he was like, did we make a mistake by putting this kind of music? My husband said, no. It's got very good music. It's got very good mixes. And, you know, they got into talking about music. And I just thought, thank you, Jesus. This is amazing. This is revival where people are not only giving their lives to Christ, but also straight away, They want to honor God even with music. So many born-again Christians have been born-again for many years, yet they are listening to secular music without a care in their lives. You know, Beyonce, and some of them are even pastors, and they are not sensitive to this. But in this revival, the Lord is quickly saving and also teaching people himself and discipling them. And, you know, so we got into talking and everything. Then I was playing with their little baby and just watching how excited he is about giving his life to Christ. And he talks about the craziest of things. He said, let me tell you, my mechanic, who I don't even know, who's a stranger, it has been telling me about how I need to give my life to Christ, telling me go and pray for 10 minutes, etc. And you know, the guy is talking about, Yanni, let me tell you, there's something God told me called heavenly conspiracy. Yes, that's what the Holy Spirit called it. The Holy Spirit told me last year at some point, or the year before, about what is called a heavenly conspiracy. And he told me that when we pray for somebody to get saved, something like what is called a heavenly conspiracy begins, but not conspiracy in a bad way, but heaven begins to release angels, release divine things, release amazing things that lead all the way to your prayer of that person being saved, coming to fruition. And let me tell you, the heavenly conspiracy, this guy, you mechanic, I don't know, driver, I don't know, shopkeepers, Yanni, from the time that we told him he needs to give his life to Christ, but also slightly before that, he had been told over and over, and my message was that one of you've got to be kidding me. Even this woman of God is saying the same thing, heavenly conspiracy. The wife has been praying for this guy to rededicate his life to Christ, calling, come home, my husband, in the spiritual realm, come home, meaning come back to the kingdom of God, you know? And she's been weeping before the Lord, and the Lord releases this heavenly conspiracy, and everything, all these ways are leading to being blocked, and we are listening in awe of God. And let me tell you, the Bible says that one plants, another one waters, but the harvest belongs to God. And I kid you not, no one can take the glory for people getting saved. God actually moves and works and leads people to salvation. So as he's talking and everything, and I'm in awe of God, and so moved by the glory of God and what God is saying and what God is doing and all that, I end up, now moving and just saying, I'm feeling like I need to go and say hi to your girls, you know? And the lady quickly stands up, and she was going to call them. I said, no, can I go to the bedroom? Is that okay? I feel like I should go to the bedroom. And she says, no, I can call them, you know? And you know, normally for me, I'm very, whether this home visit thing, I have to get used to, because, you know, I grew up being told by our parents, stop going to people's houses. That's how I grew up. So I struggle with visiting. So now going into the bedroom, for me, I would feel is a breach of privacy. But I felt the Holy Spirit push me that way. I said, if it's okay with you, can I go into the bedroom and say hi to the girls? So I got up and I went, and when I peeped, I saw one of them was asleep. And, you know, I left, but I felt like I needed to wake her up. So I came back and I said, she's sleeping, you know, and the mom came and said, no, let her wake up. So she came and the mom says, she's not feeling very well, she's got a stomachache. And I understood instantly why God wanted me to go to the bedroom. God wanted me to go to her. So we went and, you know, she turned and you could see she was in a lot of pain. She was happy to see me, but she was in a lot of pain. And then I said, honey, can I pray for you? You can't have New Year's Day with an early night. You're really young and, you know, it's a wonderful day. It's the first day of the year. You know, your daddy has just given his life to Christ. Can I pray with you so that you can enjoy the rest of the day? And she said, sure. She sat up and I laid hands on her and I began to pray for her. And the Spirit of God just began to fall. And that's something that's just been happening lately. The Spirit of God just falls and it feels like dew. It feels like rain, just the presence of God, the fire of God. And then I finished. And I was, you know, I'm learning to ask people whether whatever condition has gone instantly, because previously what I'd been used to was, you know, God would manifest himself in healing with time. So, but the Holy Spirit said, ask her. So I said, is the pain gone? And she looked at me and said, oh, it's so weird. It's gone. No, she said, it's gone. Then, you know, the mom says, is it gone? You know, and she says, mom, it's weird. It's gone. I said, not weird. It's the Holy Spirit. And this girl was instantly healed, and she was so excited about it, you know, that later on she joined us in the sitting room. Then, you know, I went to the other one, and this one was, you know, very chubby and everything, chummy and everything, and smiley, and she turned, and, you know, she was all dressed up, while laughing about how cool she looked, and she just woke it up, you know. And I turned out like, why are you dressing up? Did you know I was coming? You know, you are laughing. I love young people. And, you know, so, you know, she said, you know, would you pray with me? For her, I was just saying hi. And I said, okay, honey, I'll pray with you. And we had a discussion about what she wanted us to pray about. And the Lord really spoke powerfully after we finished. And then leaving the room, she says, you know, there's something uncomfortable about my room. Could you pray about that? And I stood there, and honestly, I could feel the fear. I could actually feel the presence, you know, of a dark being. And, you know, I just took time and prayed and declared, I need to go back and confirm how they slept and everything. But we had such an amazing time in the glory of God and the manifested move of God in the home. And I remember as we left that home, you know, having anointed the whole family, the Lord told me, this revival is bringing families back to me. You know, for quite a while, the enemy has broken families. The enemy has, and the enemy being Satan. You know, I'm learning that there are people who watch my broadcasts with a lot of courage and confidence, even though you're not born again. So when I say the enemy, you think it's people I'm talking about. So I'm learning, okay, let me explain myself. So when I say the enemy, I'm talking about Satan. So Satan has come and he's been breaking homes, quite a bit of that. And last year, I finally answered the call of God on my life in terms of doing marriage ministry. It's something I've really tried to run away from because, you know, whenever you answer marriage ministry call, your own marriage actually comes under attack. So like, you know what? Marriage is already hard enough as it is without me fighting demons that are fighting my husband and I because of ministry. I said, you know what, Lord, it's been 17 years of marriage. And I, you know, my life has got to count for something. I honestly believe that our experiences have got to count for something. So I started marriage ministry. God has really been healing marriages. He's been doing wondrous things. By the way, in a group of, we are about 15 women, because I'm just working with women so far. I don't know how to work with married men because, you know, I'm hoping my husband can join us soon, but I don't know how to work with a married man. I'm not a man. I don't know. And I don't seem to have that anointing so far. I know it will come. So I'm just working within the turf that I kind of, you know, have a release on, and that's women. And by the way, the amazing thing is, remember, women are helpers. So I found that as I work with the women, the marriages are actually being healed because God is ministering to the marriages in spite of, I don't even know, seriously, this fashion story. Anyway, I don't know why it keeps doing that. So anyway, sorry for distracting you. But yeah, the way marriages go is that if the woman can get it right, I'm actually finding that marriages can be healed. And I worked with a lady, a wonderful lady called Sumi, many years ago, 2012, when I was on the verge of giving up on my own marriage. And, you know, really, I joined Sumi's class just to confirm, you know, I've tried, but this thing is too hard. I just want to serve God. And, you know, by the way, I'd studied, and one of the things I was studying was, you know, I looked at Teresia Wairimu, and I was like, she's not married. I looked at Bishop Wanjiru and other people. I even looked at, what's her name? I was studying women. Women who are used by God greatly. And it got to the point where I was convinced that marriage maybe is not for women who serve God greatly. But really, God has been convincing me. Otherwise, he's been telling me, no, you can actually do all of them together. And you don't have to give up your marriage and be lonely so that you can serve me. I'm not that mean. I'm not that nasty God. But anyway, so we've been working with women. And if you haven't joined the class, I would really encourage you to join the class so that you can also learn from what God is teaching. But out of a group of 15 women, two, their husbands have gotten saved in just 7 weeks. Imagine. And God is beginning to do a healing work in their homes. And quite a number are reporting a change in their marriages, a change in their homes and everything. And really what we're doing is just teaching the women what it means to be a suitable helper. We are working with born-again women because it's a bit easier, because then you can tell them, pray for your husband, pray for your wife and all that, and humility and speak scripture. But you don't have to be born again to be able to join the class. Yeah, so that's what God's doing. In terms of revival, I want to encourage you to just get into prayer. Get in there into prayer. I don't know if you're fasting, if you're praying, but I would really encourage you to enter into fasting. I work with people who are born again and they tell me they've never fasted a day in their lives. I don't understand it. That is disobedience. You know, Jesus talked about when you fast. He didn't talk about if you fast. He talked about when you fast. But when you fast, but when you fast. So let us fast, let us seek the Lord's face. Let us, in this particular fast, we are looking inwards. We are looking at ourselves and we are asking God to search us, to know us. It's very easy to point at other people. But in these next few days, until the Lord releases us to the next thing, the agenda is really introspecting. We are watching how we speak and asking God to bridle our tongues. So we are doing a tongue fast as well. And a tongue fast is where you watch your mouth and you hold back words until you're sure about what you're saying. And this year, the Lord has been very clear that a lot of the anointing shall come through our mouths. So we must watch our mouths and how we speak. The other thing is that we are doing is that we are asking God to look at our habits. And we are dwelling on Galatians 5, verse 22 and 23, about the fruit of the Spirit. And we are asking God to search us that we may be able to walk in the fruit of the Spirit, you know, and live gentleness, kindness, patience, you know, joy, and all that that is in the fruit of the Spirit. Because the word of God is very clear, you will know Christians by their fruit. And it's easy to say, I'm born again, one as if we're hallelujah, but you're not working out your salvation. Let's work out our salvation. And then we are entering into saying, Lord, may you find in us vessels that can be carriers of revival, vessels that you can use. So back to the Welsh revival, 7 years, 2 years really, the main thing. But I want to just talk about, you know, in the Fiji revival, we saw that crime went down and the prisons began to become reception halls for marriages, for because people now are getting married and they needed more places. There was a demand for places for people to go their wedding receptions. Guys don't want to cohabit, because remember, when there's a great move of God, which is what revival is, the Holy Spirit himself convicts people of sin. You know, if you look at things like, you know, tell people that put in their laws about, you know, do not, there's no abortion and everything, but guys will always have backdoor clinics to still have that abortion chimi chimi. But when the Holy Spirit moves and comes down on a doctor, then the doctor will be convicted and say, I'd rather sleep hungry and I'd rather my children sleep hungry than for me to abort babies. So that's how the Holy Spirit moves in revival. Then you look at things like, you know, divorce and you know, when we are moving away from God, when we're becoming lukewarm, which is the opposite of revival, when we get used to the presence of God and, you know, we speak of, what is it called, being born again as, hey, born as if you were, amen, born as if you were, amen. But people look at you and they're like, come on, you're born as if you were, I don't even want to be saved. That is the absence of revival. But in revival, people work out their salvation without anybody even telling them. And part of what happens is that thieves choose not to steal. They get saved. They turn to God. And when you're praying and saying security has become so bad, what we need is revival. A heavy outpour, the Spirit of God that comes through prayer, that comes through gathering together, calling on the name of Jesus and saying, God, we need you. God, we want you. God, we want more of you. We want your glory. We want to see you like the apostles saw you, Lord God. We are hungry for your move. We don't want to just read about the miracles, Lord. We want to see them. And when that happens, is that even now, by the way, I'm holding back tears, as the move of God comes, even when the preacher stands to preach, people begin to weep, even without even one saying a word, because of the heavy glory of God. The house of God has bread yet once again. You know, bread being the showbread that we learn about the temple, when you look at the temple of God, you know, and the description of the brazen altar, the showbread, you know, the light of the altar and all that stuff. And the glory of God once again comes so heavy that even without, you know, preaching, people are able to turn their lives back to Christ. The other thing is that criminals give up on stealing. Remember, if a home is full of the glory of God, because the home is in a revived state, even when the enemy wants to come and steal, he can't do it, you know, and you have people being convicted, even in your home, and repenting and crying to God, and I believe we will see it happening. I feel I'm prophesying that people will come and find thieves who have been frozen by God and weeping, and they repent, and they tell you, I'm sorry, I came to steal, but God told me, you know, not to steal, and I've given my life to Christ, and you know, how do I do this? And we'll lead criminals to Christ. So please don't lynch them, okay? Don't lynch them when you find them weeping and crying and don't wonder what is going on, and don't call the cops on them. Lead them to Christ and then bring them into church, and we will walk with them. So in the Welsh revival, just like in the Fiji revival, crime went down so much, but the difference between the Fiji revival and the Welsh revival, in the Fiji revival, they gave the prison wardens a different kinds of assignments. So they became, you know, guys who are overseeing and customer service, overseeing these halls that they were using for, reception halls for weddings. In the Welsh revival, can you imagine? Cops were retrenched. Cops were laid off. Cops were laid off because there was no work for them, because there weren't as many criminals, and the government wanted to save on money. Now, the other thing that happens in revivals, and I'm finding this common, and in the Welsh revival it was very, very strong, but in Fiji as well, is that banks began to report that people who had not been paying them were suddenly paying them. Many of them were coming and paying off all the debt. But then quite a number of them who had not been paying suddenly began to pay. Why? Because when revival comes, businesses begin to thrive. Yeah, because remember, wherever Jesus went, he did good, and great things must happen every time wherever Jesus goes and his presence comes. So part of what God has spoken about this year, that's why I'm convinced that we will see a great outpour of revival, is that businesses are going to thrive. So there's no poverty and struggle where revival comes. So in the Welsh revival, the banks reported that people began to pay off their debt, either in full suddenly, it's like they were coming into some kind of loot, or they would pay all of a sudden people that were defaulting. So that's another thing that happens. So if you have debts, if you're feeling overwhelmed by debt, you just need to pray for revival. And as the great glory of God pours, then God does things. And I'll tell you, as I personally began to move into my personal revival, because revival is, there's personal revival and then there's revival for all. As I began to move into my personal revival, right from about 2013, God began to give me business ideas, and these are unique businesses that people have tried to replicate and have not been able to replicate. And you know, part of the courage of being able to move into full-time ministry was also that God has given me some businesses that at least can sustain us here and there, but really to be able to know that, you know, I'm not going to be depending completely on whether people give or don't give, because again, we are not called to do that as ministers of the gospel, because our provision comes from the Lord. If it touches people to give, we bless the Lord. But sometimes people may harden their hearts, sometimes the enemy may use people not to give, so that then you may doubt, you may be discouraged. A lot of pastors have ended up backsliding and quitting, or trying to turn people, untwist people into giving, simply because people have not heard the voice of God or obeyed the voice of God to give. So yeah, that's what I really felt to share today. Again, oh yeah, I needed to share about the prostitutes. Oh my God, I had to share about the prostitutes. Who is sending me anger messages? Either your phone is possessed, or you yourself, you have something in you. Anyway, I don't know what's going on. Yeah, but anyway, whatever that is, whatever. So the other thing that happened is brothels. Brothels is where prostitutes are, and you know, brothels in Wales suddenly had such a glory of God that they began to become places of prayer, places of worship, places of lifting up the name of God. And imagine, they just turned into little churches, into little sanctuaries of praise and worship. Wouldn't you love that? To go into K Street and people are just, yeah, no, Shari Messiah, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. And rich people are coming to pick up people and they're being told, I want to tell you about Jesus, even if they're wearing minis, you know, because we're caught in those mini states. And they're like, yeah, I want to tell you about Jesus. And Jesus is Lord and he saves. And they're like, what's wrong with you? But then the glory of God is moving. And these husbands of people and these people who are coming also to fornicate turn to Jesus, and they begin to cry and to turn to God. I want to see it, guys. I want to see it so badly. That's the cry of my heart. And then the other thing, I love this one. So they had political rallies going on just like our time. It's not a new thing. But guess what? The politicians had to go to church now. Because they would call for rallies, but people were not interested in hearing their political lies and funny stories because they were so busy calling on the name of Jesus. And by the way, they would enter into places of prayer and worship, and they would say that, you know, we are going to have a service, and they would say that the service, but notice by there, our services don't necessarily say how long they last, because revival is like that. You can't tell people this is how long you last, because God moves. And guys would pray until 3 a.m. Who had the time to go and hear what a politician has to say? No offense to politicians, but unfortunately quite a number of them are liars. But wouldn't you love it that people move away from politics, move away from, I don't know, we want to divide our nation, move away from, I don't know what, lies and whatever, and they say, you, me, I have eternity to look into, and I'm going to worship the Lord. So politicians now learn they can't even call for rallies because they end up going at a loss because people have gone to revival crusades. So they're like, where are the people? Where are the people? You know, where are the people? You know, they're asking their guys who are supposed to be rallying in people and ferrying in people. Where are the people? They say, guys have gone to pray. Guys have gone to the prayer mountain. Yeah, I hear it's full here. So the politicians started to follow the voters into the prayer rallies, hoping to get an opportunity to speak. But now they'll get overwhelmed by the Holy Spirit that they couldn't even speak. Guys, I want to see revival. I want to see that. I'm seeing it, but I want to see it fully blown out. I don't want to see it just in Sozo Church. I want to hear it happening here, in this other house, in this other place, and all that. Please share with us as it's breaking out, even as we're praying and calling on the name of God. Of course, the other thing we must remember is that what is birthed in prayer is sustained and increased in prayer. And a lot of the people have lost revival because they got caught in the works of God and neglected personal prayer time and reading the word of God and calling on the Lord. Speaking of which, we have a challenge this year. We are memorizing 200 scriptures in 365 days. 200 scriptures in 365 days. How many have I done? I've done Psalms 91. When I'm brave enough, I will say it here. Yeah, but I'm still in the process. It has 16 verses. Very tricky to memorize. I think Psalms 23 is so much easier, but still very, very powerful. So Psalm 91, so I've done 16 verses, still not perfected it, but 16 verses. Then I have done, today I did Psalm 61 verse 2. Yes, Psalm 61 verse 2. I will say, yes, oh my God, I've gone blank. But anyway, lead me to the rock that's higher than I, yeah? So that's about 17 verses, perfecting them still. And then there's First Peter chapter 1. Yes, there's something there. And then there's Deuteronomy 23, something there as well. So I'm just trying to work on them day by day. But that is the challenge. I'm walking around with a book, writing it down every day. Yeah, and then you just build it up day by day. But 200 scriptures we are memorizing in 365. By Sunday, something has to give. By Sunday, I have to have at least 7 because I need to lead by example. And so hallelujah. I have come to the end of the broadcast. And that's what the Lord had put in my heart. I'm very, very excited, guys. I can't explain it to you, but my heart is so overwhelmed with the glory of God. I am so in love with Jesus, and I'm so excited at what he's doing. And really, at this point, what I realize is that we just need to have the forum to be able to pray for people, especially the sick. But he's already released his glory and his anointing of healing in a heavy and powerful manner. Amen. The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. Let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for these dear ones, oh God, that are watching, that are taking time, Lord, that are so hungry, that are following this broadcast, oh God, clinging on, oh Lord Jehovah, because they are hungry. Not to hear from me, not to see me, but because of you, Lord. They gather because of you, Father. Won't you just feel that hunger, my Father? Your word says that blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Satisfy them, Lord, with yourself. Satisfy them with yourself. And in that satisfying them with yourself, to be hungry and hungry for you, to be able to seek you, that they may be able to pray. It's so easy to be busy, it's so easy to be caught up, it's so easy, oh God, to be when it comes to prayer. But Father, won't you put in us a hunger for you, the Lord, our prayer time would be caused by hunger, longing for you, as a deer pants for water, we may thirst after you. For Lord, the word of God is very clear that many are the plans of us human beings, but it's you, Lord, and your purpose that prevails, Lord. Let our prayers be your purpose for us, oh God. That, Lord, it wouldn't be about, you know, planning to pray, planning to seek you, planning to fast. But, Lord, that they'll be established in you, my Father. And, Lord, even as I've known that you long for us, even more than we long for you, Father. Lord, would you cause us, oh God, to be hungry for you? Oh, Papa. Our spiritual self, Lord, if not the flesh in particular, Lord, is prone to wander. Prone, Lord, to watch movies. Prone to meet with people, even with the idea of prayer. How many prayer groups are there, Lord, that are filled with the idea of prayer? That we gather to pray, but we end up talking and we realize we haven't prayed. That we gather to pray, Lord, and we realize we've spoken for 2 hours and prayed for 5 minutes. Oh my God, draw us in by the power of your Holy Spirit. Oh my Father, drive us in us a hunger, a longing for you, a desire, oh God, that is spiritual, that comes from you yourself, Lord, and from your throne, oh God, a desire to meet with you. God, cause us to move in such a way, Lord, that when we haven't prayed, we would miss you like we miss our friends. That we would long for you as we long for tea and for water and for coffee and for food. Be our very breath, oh God. And may we long for you and desire you. And God, we know you release revival. For Lord, on the 26th of October afternoon, you showed me, Lord, water fountains, and you told me you released the Joel 2 revival, my God. We just need to enter in, oh God. Father, whatever is separating us, oh God, whatever it is, Lord, whether fatigue, whether seasons, whether trials, whether troubles, Daddy, through your loving grace and your mercy, draw us to you that the things of the earth would grow strangely dim. Strangely dim. And God, as we enter in, move us into a dimension where, Lord, when the enemy comes with criticism and attacks, oh God, we'll be at a level where our affirmation comes only from you, and we don't need anyone to tell us well done, for all we want is you, Jesus. And Lord, move us into a dimension also where when people praise us, we'll not fall for the praises of men. We are fleeting, and God, we don't even want them, my Father. For all glory belongs to you, Yahweh. Lord, may we not, oh God, be caught up in that, Father, even as your word says that, Lord, you will send your angels and put charge of them over us, oh God, that their job shall be to watch us, that we will be born within their arms, oh Lord Jehovah God, that we may be committed in our will towards you, my Father, in our ways, that we may not dash a foot against a stone, my Father. Oh, hallelujah, my God. May the angels of the Lord bear us higher above the praises of men. May the angels of the Lord bear us higher above the criticism of men. May the angels of the Lord bear us higher above fatigue, above trials, above fears, above these earthly things and little foxes, oh God, that is written about in the songs of Solomon, my king. Oh God, cast them away from us, my Father, and draw us close as your bride, my God, that we may enter into this revival. That we may enjoy it, Father, that we may bathe in it, my Father, and we know that all these other things shall be added unto us, for that is your promise, and you are a promise keeper, and you never break your covenant, oh God, to your children. Hallelujah. Everything we are searching for, Lord, is found in you. Everything that we are seeking, Lord, is found in you, my God. Thank you, King Jesus. We worship you, we adore you. As our children return to school, my Father, We bless them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We speak your anointing upon them, my Father, and we speak your protection. Oh, my Lord, my God, not a hair on their heads shall be harmed, my God. We speak the blood of Jesus even now in the name of Jesus. Father, provide for your children, oh God, who are wondering, where am I going to get school fees from? Oh, God, provide. And even daughters have been praying, Lord. Would you cause people to give into the benevolence fund that we can be able to boldly say, we will sponsor this number of children, my God. Oh, Father, King of glory. Oh, God. Would you give us a source of foundation, my Father? Oh, God. That no one would lack, oh, Father God. We worship you, Lord, even as we are giving, Lord, to the poor in this season. Lord, show us how to give. Show us, teach us, oh, Father God. And teach us as your servants to be faithful, my God. How I pray, oh, Lord, that we'll not fall into the net of temptation, oh, God, as others have fallen, my Father. That, Lord, indeed would use the benevolence fund, oh, God, in the way that you've called it into, my God. And I know you're going to do great things, oh, Lord. I thank you, Lord Jehovah God. For anyone who's not feeling well right now, I speak healing. Oh, there it is, a release from the Lord. There it is. If you're not feeling well, just receive it wherever you are. Hallelujah. Healing from the balm of Gilead. By the stripes of Jesus, you are made whole. Whatever situation you're going into, I speak into it right now and I speak shalom. Remember, shalom is not the absence of war, but the presence of God. For as long as God is present, everything shall be done for you. And in Psalms 91, one of the verses that I've memorized, and it's interesting because, you know, we focus so much on protection. But the Lord says that when you set your heart on him and you set your heart to love him, that he will be with you in trouble and he will deliver you. But he also says that he'll set you on high. So whatever you're going in through, you just need to love the Lord. And the Lord just will deliver you from it because you love him. That's his promise. Imagine, it's right in there. I don't know, for some reason, I've never really seen it until I meditated upon the word of God, that you just set your heart to love the Lord and he releases his love. He releases you and delivers you and sets you on high. And he will be with you in trouble. And he promises that when you call on him, he will answer you just because you love him. Hallelujah. God bless you. Let's continue to meditate on the word of God. He loves you so much. Again, my apologies because it's not so bright in here, but tomorrow we'll do better. We'll come with better lighting. Hallelujah. I love you. I'm really praying for each and every one of you. For everyone that has liked our page, followed our page, what I do is just, I just begin to call on your names according to the names that I see and what I'm seeing. And I just pray for each and every one of you. So if you haven't liked the page as well, that would be a good thing to do. Just like the page so that you're following us, or follow the page, and we will just, I pray for you daily, and we keep on crying for you, and as the Spirit of God moves. But the another thing that I do that the Holy Spirit has led me to do is I go to comments and I pray for each person that has participated. And sometimes God gives me a word. I'm able to inbox you and tell you this is what the Lord is saying, according to the release of the Holy Spirit. The Lord is releasing jobs. That's the other thing that the Lord is saying. The Lord is releasing jobs. Somebody here is trusting the Lord for jobs. I'll inbox you later because I can't see your name. I don't want to call you out. But the Lord says he's just released your job. Hallelujah. And the Lord will do it. The Lord will do it. Remain faithful, beloved. Remain faithful. And when you get those jobs tight, circumcise the foreskin of your finances so that the enemy may not find a foothold, and give. And when you give, ask the Lord where you should give it. If you're not sure, we receive tithes and offerings to do the work of the Lord. We cannot do it without tithes and offerings. And this is fertile ground, I believe, and I'm sure you've seen that it is fertile ground. So if you're tithing and nothing is happening, ask the Lord, are you tithing into unfertile ground? Are you tithing into rocky soil? Are you tithing into thorns? Maybe the ministry that you're tithing into has moved away from the Lord and they speak about it, and therefore nothing is happening. Because the word of God is very clear that we bring all the tithes into the house of the Lord so that there may be food enough is in this temple. So the purpose is to have food, and food is what? Nourishment and preaching of the word and the souls that are being worn and constant movement. Hallelujah. Glory be to the name of the Lord. Amen. God bless you. Thank you so much. We also appreciate our partners that have really been giving to the house of the Lord. You know, guys, I just want to say thank you. We've been able to pay our what is it called? been able to pay for our meetings. We don't have a deficit. I mean, that is just the glory of God, because we use about 400,000 every month. But some of you, you're giving. I bless the Lord. Of course, I was giving my entire salary into it as well. So this month, I will get to know that it's about purely the giving of the people. I know the Lord will still cause it to happen. Thank you so much. We appreciate you. You continue to keep us open. You continue to keep us going, because we depend on your giving to be able to do the work of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We this week, I want to approach the county council, and we are looking at particular spots where babies are being dumped. We want to put in that place baby shelters. They're like little incubators, and we want to say to people, if you find a baby that's been thrown away, this is where to take the baby. So pray with us as we begin that process, as we begin also to work with children's homes, even as we're trusting God that we can register one of our own, because we want to be able to have a source of children's home where we can pray for little babies who've been thrown away. And we believe that babies who are dumped have a particular calling of God on their lives. I honestly believe that for the enemy to try to destroy that baby, there's a call of God on their lives. But really, the main reason why we are doing it is because, as we've prayed, the Lord has told us that part of the judgment that he has withheld from Kenya is because of dumping babies. And babies are being eaten by hyenas, being eaten by dogs, because we're dumping babies. So even as we begin to teach mothers that they don't need to throw away their babies, and, you know, we work with crisis pregnancy to be able to see how to, you know, teach, you know, shelter women who are pregnant but don't want to be pregnant, so we can take the babies away and give them to women who are looking for babies. Then at the same time, we want to be able to just have those baby boots where they will have a temperature control as well. Each one costs 35,000 shillings approximate, because it's 3,400 rand. They're in South Africa. So we want to be able to say, if you find a baby who's been abandoned, you can take them to this particular booth. They'll have an alarm in them. And I know some people have told me that maybe it's encouraging people to throw away babies, but no, we're not telling you go and dump your baby there. We're saying if you find a baby who has been dumped, because, you know, that is the reality of where we are at. So it will have an alarm that will ring to us, and we'll be able to go and collect those little babies and take them to a safe place. Hallelujah. Amen. So that's the project that I want to embark on. I'll be meeting with our lawyers on Monday, but in the meantime, I'm talking to some people in the county government to see what permissions we need to be able to do that. And hopefully we want to move into every county, but especially we'll be talking also to the police to find out what are the major zones and the major areas where this is happening. We would also want to go to those areas and preach the gospel, because also it shows that there's probably a gap that is there in terms of the fear of the Lord. Amen. Pray with us, guys. We've got a lot of work to do. We've got Barut Mission on the 13th of January. If you'd like to join us, please let us know. We really need hands to help us to be able also to serve. We'll be going to buy the cereals and in that place. Thank you for your giving. We've been receiving quite a bit of giving. We haven't met the budget yet, but we're trusting the Lord that by that time we'll be there. We are buying panties as well, because they don't have panties. Imagine, the last time we went there, we gave them two panties and they were crying, and quite a number of them got saved. Imagine, yani, the worth of a soul just by giving. You can go and preach to people until you're black and blue, but when you go and feed them, when you go and show them love, they very easily give their lives to Christ. And quite a number of them also got saved and also got healed. A number of them were saying, as you are preaching, I was feeling the fire of God and I got healed. A number of them are HIV positive. That's why they're widows also at the same time, because they're HIV widows. They're some of them, the children are also orphans there, of course. But the thing to note about Barut is that quite a number of these women don't have gainful employment. So what they do is that they sell changa. So a number of the ones who didn't get saved shared with their pastor that they really felt the Holy Spirit and they wanted to get saved. But if they get saved, what are they going to do? So we're also trusting God that we can be able to go there and help them to set up biasharas. I'm really, God, I know it's expensive, but I'm really believing God that we can be able to sink a well for them. We would need to at least 2 million shillings for that. I think Davis and Shatliff charges about 2 million depending on the water table. But I'm full of faith that we'll be able to set up a place for them, even for them to be able to have water. And you know, when you have water, you can do irrigation and everything. And you know, Nakuru is known as the food basket. I think it's Nakuru. Is it Eldoret or Nakuru? I think it's Nakuru, the food basket of Kenya. But if you look at it, the Barut area is so dry. So even as we trust God for rain and all that, want to believe God that we can equip them with skills. By the way, if you know various skills, like maybe you know how to do soap, to prepare soap, maybe candles and all those things, you can come with us, and so that we can introduce you, so that we can teach them how to do it. We'll give them, equip them with business skills as well, and then we can be able to tap into markets and be able to connect them with people who they can sell to. And that's how you get people out of things. We can't have people who cannot give their lives to Christ because you know, they're selling chana. It's really, really unfortunate. So let's work together and let's see what God will do. And all those things that I'm talking about are under the Benevolence Fund. So if you'd like to give to Sozo Ministry under the Benevolence Fund, you just send your giving under the Benevolence Fund, and you text us and say, you know, this is the Benevolence Fund. The number we've been posting on our timeline, you just find it there, 07 07 07 9919 0010, and then text us and say this is for the Benevolence Fund, so that we can strictly separate that. Others would assume it's tithes and offerings, which will go, of course, into keeping the gospel alive in terms of preaching it and going into preaching. Amen. Mathri Ministry will be resuming soon. See, now I'm available. Yes, during the week. We are so on. And if you'd like to be in Mathri Ministry as well, please offer yourself so that we can be able to do Rosh Mathri during the day, at least some hours of the day. We're also planning on hospital ministry, so just planning my schedule and everything so that we can be able to do all those things. So I'll update you guys. And thank you so much for standing with us. Thank you for your messages of encouragement. Thank you for your continuous giving. Thank you for your prayers. Oh, my God. Thank you for your prayers. They really keep us going. God bless you. I have to go home. My husband told me that he's quite concerned that when I that when I leave work, I might be getting home even later because of ministry. So there's that caveat that has been put by my husband. So let me dash home and go and minister to my family. Tomorrow is actually my husband's birthday, so we bless the Lord for that. And he is on holiday. He's a teacher by profession, and he's still on holiday, so we bless God for that as well. So let me be a good wife and run along home and do my balancing act. I love you guys. And please remember, wherever you are, your first ministry is your home and your marriage. You can preach to all these people, but when your coffin is rolled down one day, it's important that your family says that you are present. God does not require us to go and preach and then our family members feel that, you know, God took away their mommy, took away their daddy. So let's minister to our family members and let's get them appreciating God for his presence and for who he is in our lives. Thank you for watching. Please share the broadcast. Please like our page. I know that there are various things that we can do in terms of sponsorship and all that as a result of people liking our page and the numbers that we have. So please like our page to encourage us. Follow the page as well. I hope that you have gotten over the political drama, because in the next 5 years, we'll speak again as the Holy Spirit has led us to speak, because we are called as Sozo Church to governments and to nations. So when it comes to elections, we will declare who the Lord has appointed as president, that the people may be able to vote alongside the lines of what God has said. Forget tribalism. We are of the tribe of the tribe of the Lion of Judah. That is who we are. So let's move along and let's not miss our visitation, because we are caught up in so sour grapes because of human beings. Amen. God bless you. I love you guys. I'm praying for you. And I'm very, very excited to be able to serve you. Incidentally, now we are able to take more, you know, one-on-one prayer meetings and all that. Oh, my goodness. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for reminding me. A discipleship program on Wednesdays. We will have it on Wednesdays in Westlands from 12 p.m. To 2 p.m. every Wednesday. We're starting the class. We had wanted to start tomorrow, but now I'm not sure we can start tomorrow. So I guess we'll start next Wednesday. So if you'd like to enroll for discipleship, you want to know about Jesus, you feel like you have a call of God on your life, or you just simply want us to journey together, maybe you feel that God has connected you to me and to Sozo Ministry. Maybe you're not coming on Sundays, but you are available on Wednesdays from 12 to 2. We will happily walk with you. We're not charging anything for it. So from 12 to 2 p.m., you will need to buy a book. So I'll tell you more about that when we meet next Tuesday. But please confirm to us through our ministry line, 07 99 19 0010, just a text message just saying you want to be part of discipleship. I'm learning that a lot of Christians lack discipleship. It's just shocking, but they sincerely, it's shocking. And I thank God that I was part of the group that got saved, you know, before teaching stopped, and we moved into sow seed, you know, and prosperity and gospel, which is part of the gospel, by the way. But we've just overdone it. We need to focus on holiness and repentance. So if you'd like to know more about prayer, about what being born again is about, maybe you've been born again for many years, but you're not growing, you're not seeing anything, and you want to learn more, or just simply you just want to know more. Yeah, you may know a lot, but you want to know more. So please join us. But you need to confirm to us so that we can be able to take. I don't think I can take more than 30 people at a time. But if we end up more than that, then we'd have to book a hall, in which case, you know, maybe we'll have to tell people, you know, guys, you do need to help us to pay for the hall. But at the moment, I'm using my offices. So, you know, other than my rent, really, there's no other charge for that. So I'll not be charging for that. So 12 p.m. to 2 p.m., kuja kama umekula lunch. If you give a meal, we'd have to charge for it, okay? So jipange, all right? So between 12 and 2 p.m., if you'd like to sponsor somebody to buy a book, it's 1,000 bob. That's the cost of the book. It's 1,000 shillings. So you could do that. Maybe you're far. You're not able to come, but you'd like to sponsor someone, because some people will come and they can't afford a book. That's the truth. That's the truth of what we deal with. So there's Wednesdays from 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. So I'll teach that myself for now, as I'm equipping the other pastors, and you'll be able to do more of that. Then we have our cell group on Wednesday evening in Valley Arcade. If you'd like details of that, you're in that general area, then you can let us know about that. Though for cell groups, we want more of people who come to Sozo Church, because it will be quite a bit of Sozo matters. Then on Sunday mornings, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., we'll have discipleship as well. That's another discipleship class. So if you're in the Wednesday one, you need not be in the Sunday one, unless you want to just come more and more. That's okay. Yeah, but from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., we'll do that at Lillian Towers, Nairobi Safari Club, where we have our services. And then at 10 o'clock, we'll move on to have our services. And then our services run from 10 to about 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, depending on how the Spirit of God is moving. And then normally we just bless the people, but we continue with overflow service thereafter, all the way to about 4 p.m., 5 p.m. So we continue in prayer, moving as the Holy Spirit leads and all that. So there are no shortcuts, guys. You know, I know quite a number of you tell me, you know, say a word over my life. It doesn't really work that way. I could say a word over your life, but it's better to come and learn, to come and grow, and to come and move with God and whatever. If you're outside the country, that is different. We'll trust the Lord for us to be able to see how to do the discipleship live as well. We'll try and see how to do that. Amen. God bless you guys. And I'm here to serve you. You know, I've laid down my life for the sake of the Church of Jesus Christ on a full time, and really praying for you is part of what I'm doing for the rest of my life. Amen. God bless you guys. I love you. I've said that so many times, haven't I? And imagine, in spite of the love that I feel, which feels like a lot of love, God loves you so much more. And he knows everything about you, you know, and he loves you so much more. Please pray. And, you know, don't let the throne of grace be empty without somebody appearing to pray. Be that person that appears before the throne of grace and you just say, Lord, I just came to say thank you. I just came to turn up and to tell you that I love you. Let's move to that kind of prayer where we're not necessarily asking for anything, so that even in good times, we still have the reason to pray. Amen. Good night, guys. From Nairobi, Kenya, let me run home. I would love to say naenda kupika, but hatujafika hapo. Amen. Bless you guys. In Jesus' name, amen.